with me this morning, I want to open us up in a word of prayer. Dear Lord, and our God and our Heavenly Father, you're a great and awesome God, Lord. And today, Lord, is a day that you have made, and we shall rejoice in it. And Father God, I just ask you to be with your church this morning, Lord. We're separated in presence, Lord, physically, but not spiritually. And I just pray today that you'd bind us all together in the one name in which every demon must flee, Lord, and that's the name of Jesus. I pray today that we're binded together in our worship, Lord. I pray that our hearts are unified in praise and glory and honor to your holy name. I just ask you today, Lord, that you'd guide my heart and tongue, Lord, the way you want it to be, and hide me behind the cross. And I just pray for everybody out there listening, for those that are in this room this morning. Father God, I just pray that our hearts might be pricked and humbled. You know, all of us today, Lord, we are called, Lord, to make ourselves right before you, Lord. Our challenge is not to fix our brother, but ourselves. And I just pray today, Lord, that you might illuminate that in your word, and that you might just use my words, Father God, to anoint and prepare and prick and lead and convict hearts as you'd have it to be. And Father God, I just pray that your will is going to be done, Lord, that you will see this through. And I know, Father God, that you work out all things for your own ends, even the wicked, for your own righteous day. And Lord, I know that there will be a time that you'll right all the wrong. But in this day, Lord, it's our job as your people to praise and glorify your name and seek you in your word. And I just pray that would happen today. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to tell everybody something. Now, as to my understanding of the word of God, Satan is an anointed cherub. And an anointed cherub's job is a worship. He was a worship leader. He was an angel of worship. He was constantly in the presence of God. And Satan was kicked out of heaven for jealousy. Now, I believe that Satan cringes at worshiping God. I believe that it is the worst thing that could happen in his day. I think he hates when people's voices and hearts are together, when God's name is proclaimed. And I think right now in our nation and in the world, Satan's got this little sniggering grin on his face because church houses are empty and people can't be where they need to be praising the word of God. And Satan feels like he's the victor. But I'm reminded of Job. He told God, "I'm gonna make Job curse your face." And he took everything away from Job. He made Job have pain beyond what almost anybody could imagine. And when he done that, Job fell on his knees and praised the God of heaven. And in that story, I can just almost see Satan's teeth just grist together saying, "I hate that guy." Because he refused to stop praising God. And I'm challenging the church everywhere. Anybody that's listening today, you may not be sitting in your normal pew. You know, we're creatures of habit, and we got our own little place at church. You know what I mean? It might not be your comfort zone this morning. It might not be exactly the way you're used to, but this morning your job's to praise God wherever you're at. I don't care if you're sitting on your couch in a recliner in a weird church pew. Wherever you are, praise God with every ounce of your soul, because that is what you were created to do, is glorify the name of the King. Now, last week we finished our message with Second Chronicles 7:14, that passage of Scripture. And I cannot get this passage of Scripture off my mind this week, because God said, well, actually Solomon prayed. Now think about this. This is the wisest man that's ever lived, Solomon. And he prayed to God, "God, if your people abandon you," now wrap your minds around this for a minute. If your people abandon you and they turn away from you and you have to shut off the rain from heaven, or you have to send a plague among your people, a pestilence among their crop, if you turn them over to their enemies and in their terrible situation, if your people call on your name and ask you to deliver them, will you please hear from heaven and heal your people? And Solomon had an answer to that prayer in a dream. The Bible says in a vision, God came to Solomon. And he said, "Solomon, when," not if, "when my people turn against me, and when my people sell me out, And when I cut off the rain from heaven, and when I send a pestilence among their crops, and when I send a plague among my people, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I'll heal from heaven and heal their land. Not if, but when. When this happens, I'll stand up and fix it. And I've been thinking about that this week, and that verse right there, man, that's just good stuff. You guys got to get this. God said, when my people, now not the world, God's people, when my people examine their own hearts, when they seek me, seeking God is to examine your own hearts. You see, that's one thing that I think the world has missed for a long time. You cannot seek God until you start looking deep inside your heart. When you start looking inside your heart and you start self-examining, self-evaluating yourself, holding yourself up to the Word of God, you're seeking God. When my people, when they dig deep inside my Word and they dig deep inside themselves and they examine themselves, if they will turn from their wicked ways and seek my ways, I'll hear from heaven and I'll heal their land. Man, I tell you what, that's heavy stuff, folks. I want to tell you something that you have to understand. Well, first of all, I'm going to read you a passage of Scripture that is this. I love this. I'm a Psalms guy. Ricky says all the time, you and Gina, y'all get more out of the Psalms than anybody I ever seen. I think he's calling us simple-minded, Gina. He says, you just read the simplest little bitty Psalm and you just get, and man, it just speaks to you and it don't speak to me that way. And I guess I am simple-minded, but in Psalm 61, which is one of my favorite Psalms, and I find myself there so many times, this week I can't get Psalm 61 off my mind. I've been thinking about the Chronicles 7:14 passage, and I guess keep coming back to this Psalm 61 saying, listen to what David says. He says, hear my cry, O God, and listen to my prayer, for from the ends of the earth I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the foe. I long to dwell in your tent forever and take refuge in the shelter of your wings. For you have heard my vows, O God, and you have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. Now, if you're following along in your Bible today, you want to put your finger in Psalm 61 because we're going to skip around a little bit, but we'll be back. David is writing this psalm, or at least I think it's David. It is definitely a David-like. And most people believe that David wrote this psalm. But Psalm 61, the psalmist, and I think it was David, is going through a very tough time in his life, obviously. And he says to God, God, I call to you from the ends of the earth. In my distress, God, I'm crying out to you. But listen to this. Listen to his prayer. Listen to that verse right there. I call as my heart grows faint, God. Listen to what he wants God to do. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I am. Now, I want you to grasp this for a minute. David realizes he's in a real tough situation in his life, right? And he knows, as anybody in this room, anybody out there listening on social media, anybody in this world ought to understand, trials do a lot of things to a lot of people. Facing us now in this nation are a lot of unanswered questions physically, financially, emotionally, and mentally. I don't know what's going to happen. Some say it is financial damnation. Some say it's financial salvation. That when this is over, it'll go through the roof. Others say it'll never be the same again. If you've been listening to some of this media, one person says, oh, we got nothing to worry about. This thing right here, when this is over, we won't do nothing but skyrocket. And somebody else says, we're doomed. Right? I don't know the answer, but I do know this. Spiritually, trials only do one of two things to everybody. They either lead you closer to God or farther away. You're either going to get bitter or you're going to get better, but there ain't going to be but two options when it comes to your spiritual life in this trial. David knows that, and he's praying that in this great trial he's in, that God brings him to the rock. Now, what's the rock? Well, David does a good job of answering his own questions in the Psalms. Listen to Psalms 18, 1 through 3. You'll like this. This is David speaking. He says, I love you, O God, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer.
God, my God, is my rock in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise, and I am saved from my enemies. David makes no secret who his rock is. He knows his rock's God. And he's praying that this terrible time that he's going through will lead him to that rock that is Christ. Now, I want to tell you something, folks. We here, the church, everybody that's listening to this message, we need to get what David's heart said in this prayer and pray that this time right here leaves us in a place that we're closer to God than we've ever been before. Because if that happens, he will have took what Satan meant for evil and has turned it into good. This God here, our nation stands on the verge of revival or defeat spiritually. This is it. I mean, this is it. This is a chance. You understand that this trial is going to bring some people to a rock they're going to trip over. Some people are going to fall on their face because of this. When I turn on the news, I see people who proclaim to have a faith that's living like fools, which is someone who's ignorant of God. They're living like they don't know that God is still almighty. They're living like it's over and there ain't no hope and they're shutting themselves in hopelessly and joylessly inside themselves. I'm not talking about staying 6 foot away and practicing social distancing and all that stuff. That's good sense. I'm talking about their spiritual life. They're shutting themselves in a hopeless situation. Let me give you an example. God's people, Israel. The book of Numbers 14. We're going to go there in just a minute if you want to turn. Numbers 14 if you're out there listening. Numbers 14. God had brought his people Israel out of some really bad stuff. They was in Egypt. They was in bondage. They cried out to God, God, please help us. We're in bondage beyond what we can stand. And God heard their cry and he sent Moses to deliver them. And he gave Moses a helper, which was Aaron. And they go to Pharaoh and they make a claim to Pharaoh and Pharaoh says no. And through a series of 10 plagues, God brings them out of Egypt. Everybody remembers that story. He takes them through the Red Sea, sits down on Sinai in a billow of smoke and reveals himself to them in a way that God hadn't revealed himself to anybody. He lets quail land at their feet and water shoot up out of rocks and God just shows a miracle beyond miracle beyond miracle. And he brings these people to the Jordan region, and he tells Moses, I want you to get some spies together, Moses. I want you to send them over, and I want you to look at the land that I've given you. Notice my words there. He tells Moses, go look at the land I've given you, not at the land I'm going to give you. It was done, folks. The promise, this is a 400-year-old promise to Abraham. God had already told him, this is your land. Go look it over. This is your land. Numbers 14 there. Passage of scripture I just paraphrased. I'm going to read you a little bit of it. Numbers 14. Actually, no, I'm not. Numbers 14 there. He told the people, go look at it. And they sent the spies over. And the spies come back and said, you know what? That land's good. Woo! That land's good. Man, that thing will grow taters big as footballs. That ain't exactly what they said, but I'm paraphrasing. There's fruit on trees over there like you ain't never seen before. They got vineyards over there, got grapes on them big around the end of your thumb, man. That place over there, it's happening. But I want to tell you something. Them guys over there big. I mean, I'm talking about cornbread fed big. I'm talking about these guys over here as giants. They said, I believe we've seen the Nephilim over there in that country. I ain't going over there. Them people made me feel like a grasshopper. That's what they said. And that night, everybody started crying. These people are godly people. They walked through the Red Sea. Man, they seen the 10 plagues. They felt Sinai shake like a dog shakes a squirrel. God's presence set out on it, and they all sat around crying. Listen to what it says there, Numbers 14:1. It says, that night all the people of the community raised their voices and they wept real loud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, if only we'd have died in Egypt. Wrap your minds around this, folks. If only we'd have died in Egypt. Or out there in that desert. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and our children will be taken as plunder. It won't even be better. It won't be better. It'd be better for us to go back to Egypt, they said to each other. We should choose a leader to go back to Egypt. Folks, think about that for a minute. Think about that. Wrap your mind around that. God told them to go over there and look at the land I'm going to give them, and they went over there, and hey, that land was nice. But there was obstacles in that land. There was big people. And everybody, I mean, they'd already seen the miracles of God, and they sit down and cried like a bunch of wimps, like a bunch of fools, like a bunch of worldly people that has forgot that God is still El Shaddai. And that night they said, you know what, we'd be better off if we just died in Egypt. I wish we'd have died over in Egypt. We'd been better off if we'd have died out there in that desert somewhere. I'll tell you what, we'll get a leader together and we'll go back to Egypt. How stupid can a people be? How fast can a people forget who God really is? You know, we live in such a time where we have forgotten who the nation is under. We're one nation under God. I want to tell you something, folks. Our schools has dumbed our kids down to the truth for many, many generations of the miracles behind our nation. George Washington hidden in a massive fog as he crosses the Delaware in front of the British Army, so thick that they couldn't even see him right in front of their face. It set down as soon as he needed to, and it raised as soon as it was over, and some people would call that a coincidence, but George Washington called it a miracle. Our forefathers, they'd done things beyond explanation, beyond human ability. They call it miracles. It's right there in our national library. It's still recorded. You can still read it, but we want to hide it. We don't want people to know the God that built this nation. And so we just got a bunch of people sitting around crying, saying it's over because Wall Street might fall and the economy might not never be the same again. And what would we do? I tell you what we'd do. We'd trust the same God we did to get here. That's what we'd do. They started crying. Listen to what God says there. I should have marked my spot. Numbers 14:11. This right here is good stuff. You got to wrap your mind around this. Numbers 14:11. It said, the Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the miracles and all the miraculous signs I've performed among them? Think about that. How long will these people treat me with contempt, Moses? How long will they refuse to believe in a God who showed them miraculous sign after miraculous sign after miraculous sign? Folks, I want to tell you something. Now is when faith gets up and moves. Now is when people have joy in the face of adversity instead of going around looking like somebody just kicked their dog. Now is when your joy will be defined by your God rather than your circumstances. We got some tough circumstances. We got an awesome God. You know what I mean? Those people sat there and they cried. God said, what is wrong with these people, Moses? How long are they going to treat me with contempt, Moses? When will these people believe in me? And so you know what God did? He turned them over to their faithlessness and said, none of you will ever see that land. You remember the story. Every one of you will die in this desert except Joshua and Caleb, who had faith in me. The rest of you will die. Some people are going to trip over this rock and they're going to forget who their God is and they're going to forget how big their God is because they're focused on how big their problems are. There's other people that's going to find a rock to throw. I've been seeing that a lot lately. Man, I want to tell you something. The Jewish people, they love to throw rocks. And the church of today, there's no different. We love to chuck a rock, man. We love to find somebody we can get a rock in on, you know. We love it. We want to say that person don't got no faith. Right? We like that. But I want to tell you something, folks. You can have faith and not be in the will of God. I want to tell you a few examples I've been thinking about this week that's really spoke to me because I'm a rock chucker myself. I like chucking a rock or two and saying, that guy right there needs to get himself right. God's saying, Derek, why don't you just work on you and I'll take care of that guy. You know what I mean? There in Acts 19, these old boys, seven Jews. I was talking to Ricky about this story. You know, Paul was going around casting out demons and Peter, and he was healing people that landed in his shadow, and Paul was sending handkerchiefs out that he'd prayed over, and it was healing people. Man, that stuff gets catching, you know. People like being in the slime light and spotlight. And so these seven old Jewish boys, they's going to cast out a demon. And they went into this demon-possessed man's house, and these seven old boys there, you can look it up in Acts 19, they said, in the name of Jesus, in whom Paul preaches, we demand you out. And the old demon-possessed boy said, Jesus, I know, and Paul, I know, but who are you? And it says he beat them so bad that they run out of the house bleeding and naked. You can see these seven old boys coming out there naked and bleeding, getting out there, you know, limping as they go, saying, Lord, have mercy, that guy must have a demon. No kidding, that's what you went in there to cast out, you know what I mean? The reality is, folks, you can be in faith and not in the center of God's will. They had faith that Jesus could cast that demon out, but they weren't in his will. They weren't in his will when they went in there. They were in their own will. Joshua and the people, they went to Jericho and watched the walls fall because they were obedient. We was talking about that back here in the prayer room this morning. They done exactly what God said, and they rejoiced when God's plan come through. But you know what? They weren't really obedient. Achan hid some stuff in his tent he wasn't supposed to hide. And you know what? That wasn't the only problem they had. There was a little old city down the road named Ai. And Joshua and the leaders, they didn't seek God's guidance before they went there. Joshua said, hey, there's another little old city down the road. And one of the guys said, you know, it ain't real big. He says, well, send some guys to look it over and let's see what we need to do. And so they sent some scouts down to come back and said, hey, that's a little old bitty place down there. They ain't much. Said, I tell you what, we had 2,000 or 3,000 soldiers. They wouldn't stand a chance. So Joshua said, take 3,000 soldiers and go down there and just annihilate that place. And he looks back down the road and here his soldiers comes back, but there's 36 less than they was, and the rest of them look like they've been a hold of a bear catch. You know what I mean? They went down there to this little old city because they had faith, but they were outside the will of God, folks, and it didn't work. You can have all the faith you want, but until you're in the will of God, God is not going to bless your efforts. Amen. You have to be in the center of God's will. You have to be seeking his presence in your life. You have to be assured that you're where God wants you to be. But back there at Psalm 61, David said, Lord, I'm asking you, I'm crying to you, I'm pleading with you to lead me to the rock that is higher than I am. And folks, I want to tell you something. There are some people in this great test we're about to go through, we are in the middle of right now, that's going to find themselves standing on that high rock, which is Jesus Christ. They're going to find themselves that they're better Christians now than they were when things were looking good. They're going to find that they're right now they're a better Christian than they was when the Dow was going up every day and when you could go to the grocery store and buy all the toilet paper you wanted. You know what I mean? They're going to find that they're better Christians in today's time than they was in the time before. But David says something in Psalm 61 that we just got to wrap our mind around today. I just couldn't leave here feeling good about it without bringing this up. David said there in Psalm 61, lead me to the rock that's higher than I, because you've been my refuge and a strong tower against the foe. That's verse 3. Now listen to verse 4 and 5. For I long to dwell in your tent forever and to take refuge in the shelter of your wings. For you have heard my vows, God, and you have given me a heritage of those who fear your name. Woo! Let me tell you something. That heritage of those who fear your name gives me goosebumps. Do you know what it means to have a heritage of those who fear his name? I want you to listen to me this morning. If you don't listen to anything else I say, you listen to what I'm about to say. Every church member is not the church. So wait a minute, that's not politically correct. You can't say that. I'm saying you have to do more to be the church than to join a church. If you're going to share in the inheritance of those who fear God's name, it takes more than being on a church row. It takes more than a baptism certificate or a perfect attendance ticket or whatever you got, a Bible with your name on the front. If you're going to share in the inheritance of the saints, it requires something more. Peter hit the nail on the head in 1 Peter chapter 1, which is where we're going to wrap up today. 1 Peter chapter 1, this right here is good stuff, man. 1 Peter chapter 1, he starts there in verse 3. He says, praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and his great mercy has given us a new birth into a living hope, through the resurrection of Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through the faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer trials, and you may have to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proven genuine and may result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him, are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Man, I want to tell you something. This right here gets my candle lit right here. Peter says, let me tell you something, church. Let me tell you something. Listen here in verse 3. Praise be to God, the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, in his great mercy has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I tell you what burns me up is all this equality religion garbage, where we want to put everybody on the same page and everybody's got equal hope and we all just need whoever you pray to pray. Baloney. Whenever Buddha walks out of his own grave and Allah makes something out of nothing, we'll talk about equality, but till they do, they ain't jack in my book. Jesus Christ is who brought us a living hope, because the grave couldn't hold him, the cross couldn't take him, and he's alive and well, and he has bore my shame and defeated my sin, and I got a hope in eternal life, and that's a new hope. He said, let me tell you something, church. Jesus Christ has given you a new birth. The old man's gone. The guy that used to live in fear, the guy that used to get his hope from the TV and the circumstances, that man, he dead and gone. They done buried that sucker. Don't dig him up. He's gone. You got a new hope. You got a new birth through a resurrected Christ. And I want to tell you something, folks. Your heritage is awaiting you. One of these days, he's going to come back. And when he does, your heritage will await. When he does, you'll be a co-heir with Christ. Your name is on the deed book of heaven. You will be in the presence of the Almighty. You will share in the perfection of Eden. You will have all things new. But until then, you are shielded by God's power until the coming of his salvation. If Jesus is your daddy, who are you afraid of? You know what I mean? If God is your father, if he's in your corner, who are you afraid of? He said you have been shielded by the power of the Almighty until the return of Christ. I don't know how bad it's going to get, but I know one thing, God's going to be bigger. If he's in my corner, I'm pretty cool. You know what I mean? Folks, it says you're going to suffer griefs and trials of many kinds. If you don't just believe me, turn on the news. You know what I mean? It's here. This ain't a new thing. Pestilence been coming among mankind since we had mankind. It's a result of sin. We live in a fallen world. People's going to die and suffer all kinds of grief till the Lord comes back. But his own people are under the protection of his hand. You know, cancer's a terrible thing. I hate it. But it's probably got more people ready to meet Christ than the lottery ever will have a chance. You realize that, right? Because when the doctor tells you, hey, man, this could be go time, you get real. You know what I mean? You get real. All of a sudden, you start learning and seeking and finding out what life is all about. Now, this morning, I want to tell you something. I don't know how to do this other than to be honest, so I'm just going to be them dang honest in the next few minutes. God said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I'll heal from heaven and I'll heal their land. And I believe my land needs healing. And I believe God's the only hope. And if I'm going to look at Chronicles 7:14 for what it says, then I'm going to put Derek in the picture and nobody else. And God says, Derek, if you want your heart ready to meet me in prayer, if you want me to listen to your prayer for this nation, then you have got to humble yourself and seek my face and turn from your wicked ways. And so I'm going to tell you this morning about me. I'm going to tell everybody listening out there on Facebook, I'm going to tell you about me. I have come to the realization in my life that I have stunk at being a mountaintop Christian. A mountaintop Christian is when everything is going your way. And I have been a lot better at seeking God in deep valleys than I have on mountain peaks. I find myself drifting away from God when I think I got life by the horns. I find myself, when everything is good, being lax in my relationship with God, not seeking him like I should in prayer, not seeking him like I should in his word, not digging after him and longing for him. I stink as a mountaintop Christian. That's just me. I struggle with pride. I didn't think I had a pride issue till I started studying on pride, and now I realize I'm plagued with pride, and the biggest thing that stands between any man and God is pride. Pride keeps you from being honest about your relationship with God and giving up the things that God wants you to give up. We want to keep some things to ourselves. We say, God, you got access here and you got access here, but now this stuff right here, I don't know. We got this little place in our life locked away where we won't let God at, because the truth is we like that part. I want to tell you something, folks. The biggest part of the world is in love with some sort of sin more than they are with God. The biggest part of the church is in love with some sort of sin more than they are with God. That's just the reality. And God says, when you own your sin and you meet me with a consecrated heart, we'll talk about healing your land. And I want to tell you something, folks. You can't come to God with welcome sin in your life. You can't come to God with harbored pride in your life and say, God, heal my land. That wasn't the deal. That's not the deal. And that's not what he said. David said in Psalm 61, God, lead me to the rock that's higher than me. David knew that he was capable of major mistakes. He knew that he was capable of pride destroying him. He knew that he was capable of pride saying, God, this is all your fault, and why would you do this? I just almost had it, and then now this went along. I told somebody the other day, and I mean, I'm just being honest this morning. I'm talking about being honest. I said, you know, I mean, I had a couple of tough years in the agriculture business, and right here things were set up to be good, and some old boy eats a bat, and then I'm right back to the bottom. Just don't understand. God, why did you do this? You know what I mean? You say, God, I just don't get it. I mean, every time I get one foot up on the ladder, the rung breaks. Folks, this is not about the stock market. This is not about the note at the bank. This ain't about the light bill. This ain't even about groceries. This is about who's God and who's not. And America has made a major mistake. They have forgot that God is still almighty. They have forgot that El Shaddai still sits on the throne and Jesus still wears on his hip, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's who he is. That's who he's going to be. He works out all things for his own ends, you know. They stood there on the bank of the Jordan River and refused to own their blessing. They refused to own it. God said, I give you that land, go get it. And they refused to own it. And the Bible says that I'll give you a peace that passes all understanding. And there's Christians every day refusing to own it because they won't trust this God who promised it. There's Christians every day that don't have any hope in this life. Even though they have all hope, they refuse to own that hope because they're forgetting that God said, I'll go to prepare a place to you, and if I go, I'll be back to get you. They're not owning their hope. There are people right now in Christ who refuse to rejoice. And Paul said, I'm going to say it again, rejoice. They refuse to do that. They refuse to own their joy because some cat on the TV said there ain't no hope. They have refused to hone the truth that God gave them, that I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you, I'll work out all things for the good of those that love me. They forget that. They refuse to own it. But I'm just about sick of being robbed. I don't know what they can do to the stock market. I don't know what they can do to America, but I know what they can do to my soul. Nothing. I don't let them. My God owns me. I surrendered my soul to him. My hope and my joy is in Christ. And I want to tell you something, folks. Put a smile on your face because Christ is still Christ. There's still an empty tomb over there at the bottom of a little old hill. Buddha's got a marker. Mohammed's got a marker. Jesus don't need no marker. He's coming back. When he comes back, he's going to be the victors with him. We're going to go with him. We're going to inherit the kingdom. But until we do, folks, his presence is all over his people. God says, my presence abides with the worship of my people, with the praises of my people. My presence abides with the praises of my people. Woo! I want to tell you something. Where God's being praised, that's his church. I don't care if it's at the church house, at your house, in the backyard. I don't give a rip if you own the car on the way to work. If you're listening and you're praising, you're part of God's people, and His presence abides with you. But you got to ask yourself a question. Am I spending my time judging the guy beside me? Jesus said, why do you get the speck out of your brother's eye? Why you got a plank in yours? Man, I've been thinking a lot about that. I don't know if any of the Pharisees is left alive, but Pharisaical ways did not die with the Pharisees. It's still alive and well. I'm a plank-eyed sinner. No, Derek's a plank-eyed sinner. I want to get the speck of dust out of some other guy's eye saying, hey, buddy, if you stand still for a minute, that's bothering me. I'm going to pick that right out there for you. You know, you ain't got enough faith. You just ain't got enough faith. You ain't trusting in God. You know what I mean? I'm going to point fingers and throw rocks, and God says, Derek, I don't need you to fix them. I called you to humble yourself and pray and seek my face and turn from your wicked ways. You get on your knees and let me take care of that guy. Folks, I want to tell you something. If America's got a hope, it's the church. I think our government's doing a pretty dadgum good job. But I want to tell you something, folks. The government cannot fix this nation. They can't do it. They could sustain it for a little while, but folks, not for long. God built this nation, and it'll be God that can sustain it. It'll be God that heals it. He is the hope of America. I don't give a rip what nobody says. If they don't believe it, they're in the wrong place, I'll tell you. We're going to have a hymn of invitation. Now, if you're out there on Facebook, I want to tell you something. Your couch is as good an altar as any altar. I got saved one night and knelt beside my couch. That's the God's truth if I ever told it. My altar was a lazy boy because it's the best thing I had. And I want to tell you something. I met God beside a lazy boy. Because God didn't ask what kind of altar you was knelt down beside. The truth is the altar's your heart. God will meet you at your heart when you open the door and let Him in. Maybe you need salvation. If you need salvation, get on your knees and ask God to be your Savior. If you need rededication, get on your knees and ask God to rededicate you. If you need guidance, if you need just God asking God, help me, God, to lead me to the rock that's higher than me, get on your knees and seek this great and awesome God. But I want to tell you something this morning. An altar call is not about the preacher. An altar call is not about anybody else in the room. It's just between you and God. If you want to pray from your seat, if you want to pray from wherever you're at out there, pray. But I pray today that whatever God's laid on your heart, you'd get it right. Won't you come as we sing our invitation hymn?